Hey guys, welcome to the July edition of Show and Tell. I'm joined here by our global team of FS experts, most of whom are going to share some links of inspiration today for the month. Your only job is just to sit back, relax, and be inspired as we go through the links. And with that said, I'm going to jump right to the doc. I think I'm actually first up today. I'm Michael Fisher, one of the creative directors, VP of menswear here. My first link is something that really kind of just spoke to me in a really romantic way. It was a science article. I don't normally come upon them too often, but what I really loved about it is that a bunch of geologists and scientists have basically discovered that Earth has a heartbeat. What I loved about that term is that a lot of our recent visionaries over the last few seasons have really kind of added human characteristics to Mother Nature. And I love this idea that every like 27 and a half million years, there is a heartbeat in our world. So what does that mean? So let me just scroll down to this graph and I'll kind of explain what it is. So they have been trying to pinpoint for a long time when major events happen on the Earth. And so this includes things like volcanic activity, mass extinctions, plate reorganization, sea level rises. It's a very slow process. And for a long time, they kind of thought that it was around 30 million years. They've now pinpointed it to 27 and a half million year cycle of catastrophic ebbs and flows. Luckily for us, we have another 20 million years before the next pulse of the heartbeat. A lot of times, a lot of scientists thought that geological events were random, but now they actually believe that there's a more common cycle to it. And I thought that was really interesting. So they looked at 89 well understood geological events from the past 260 million years and kind of came up with this timeline. And I thought it was so, so interesting. What's really interesting is that for a long time, a lot of scientists thought that things like comet strikes could be the cause of this pulse. One researcher suggested that Planet X is to blame. But actually, if Earth really does have this geologic heartbeat, it may be due to something a lot closer to home. They say that these pulses of tectonics and climate change actually may be the result of geophysical processes related to the dynamics of plate tectonics and mantle plumes. So really, really cool. Just love that idea. Love that term that Mother Nature has a pulse. My next link is from Mr. Porter. This also is a great confirmation of some things that we've been touching on in our cultural sentiments over the last few seasons. They've launched a new collaboration called Small World Initiative. I'll kind of scroll through here while I show you some pictures, but basically what it is, it's a curation of global independent and diverse brands that celebrate craftsmanship, responsibly made products and local communities in a very thoughtful and intentional way. It includes apparel, accessories, and homeware as well. It's 33 brands total, but they all have to have virtue of various qualities like, that they're very proud of the place from, you know, where they come, skilled heritage craftsmanship, also their support of regional artisans or the use of recycled and low impact materials. And of the 33 brands, 16 are brand new to Mr. Porter and Net-a-Porter. There's about 400 products total that are in the initiative as at launch, and like 200 of them are exclusive to the site. What I really loved about it is that each brand also sits within Mr. Porter's newly launched craftsmanship code, and it is an evergreen selection on the site designed to champion products made by brands that make a positive contribution to their communities and operate with environmental and social considerations at the forefront of their design. So if you go into Mr. Porter, you can check out the entire shop, but I really loved that. And then to go along with that, Alex Mill, which is a brand that I really love and it's been getting a lot of buzz over the last couple of years, they have a new collaboration with Quiet Town. And Quiet Town is actually a New York-based shower or bathroom accessories brand. They're known for their canvas shower curtains and shower accessories. So what Alex Mill did is they teamed up with them to bring a clothing collection that was pieced together using colorful canvas shower curtain scraps that the brand has been using for the last couple of years. And they did it in their most iconic silhouettes, their work jacket, And then they have a short that they are known for as well. So really colorful. When they launched this at Instagram, they used all these cute little models using the scraps, which I thought was super pretty. But you know, Quiet Town has been doing this re-canvas initiative for ever since they launched. So basically it's upcycling using canvas for the bathroom accessories. And now they've kind of taken those scraps and made them into some apparel items as well. But I love the color palettes. I thought they were really sweet and sugary and summery. So you can go on there and check them out. There's very few, it's very limited edition just because they use, I think 300 pounds of scraps for the entire collection. So yeah, 300 pounds. So, all right, so those are my links. Next up is Mallory. Hi, Mallory.
Hi everyone, I'm Mallory. I'm a beauty and wellness strategist here at Fashion Snoops. My only theme for today is an injection of pure pop culture joy in the form of Ted Lasso, which is not a new show, but it's gaining a bit of renewed traction right now because season two is coming up, and also this live tweeting, live watching thread went viral recounting this woman's experience watching the show. For those who are unfamiliar with this show, I cannot recommend it enough. It's resonating with consumers and viewers for many, many good reasons, mainly the simple fact that it's based on just the idea of being a decent and good human. We know that positivity and kind of this nostalgic, optimism is really an important cultural discussion that we're having right now. And this show is just pure goodness. I don't know who else on the FS team has watched it, but I find myself really inspired by it right now. It's on Apple TV and the new season premieres in a couple of weeks. I think it's July 23rd. It's definitely on track to win a bunch of awards, but it really brings together a few discussions. And this thread is also hilarious if you haven't watched it. Also tying into the fact that these live tweeted threads are becoming a big part of the pop culture conversation and watching these viral and really popular shows. But if you haven't watched it, I cannot recommend it enough. It's one of those shows that everyone tells you to watch and you know you should watch, and then you break down and watch it and you're like, why did I wait so long? That was my case. It is super, super charming, and definitely read this thread afterwards. I put in a few more links that are some reviews that if you are uninitiated, can kind of give you their reviews and give you kind of more of a scope of why it's good, why you should watch it. But it's just the most relentless delight. It's incredibly funny. It'll make you laugh, it'll make you cry. And it's just what's on my brain right now. So can't wait for season two, and I highly recommend.
Everybody loves Jason Sudeikis. Thanks, yeah, Mallory, indeed. Appreciate it. Yeah, check it out for sure. Taryn, hi, you're next.
Hi, everyone. I'm Taryn. I'm a beauty and wellness strategist here at FS. So for my first link today, it's about a new Netflix show called Q-Force. So it's a new animated series about LGBTQ+ heroes. It's set to release September 2nd. And I just thought that we could watch the trailer. It was super fun. And I think it's going to be a really fun series.
Hey, Twink. Oh, hey, girl. That's my job, Daddy. Right. We're Q-Force. We're the first queer agents in the field ever. Don't stop. That's called an entrance, by the way. The world, don't hit me hard right now. Room's empty. I wasted all that masculinity on nothing.
Not nothing. My little butthole went boop.
Damn it. You can't pander to the gays. They can smell it. You're acting like Citibank at Pride.
I just thought that was really fun, and I can't wait to see how the series does. All right, so for my next link, I don't know how many of you are familiar with this, but there's been some backlash against the Olympics and the water sports world governing body FINA. So FINA had announced and said that these special swim caps called Soul Caps would not be allowed to be used in international competitions, including the Tokyo 2020 Olympics. So there's been a lot of backlash against this. And basically, sol caps are swim caps made for hair like afro hair. So there's afros, dreadlocks, braids, really thick, curly hair. And a lot of people are kind of talking about how Black swimmers, it's really hard for them to be in the sport in the first place. And these caps are really necessary for them. The pool water and chemicals can be really damaging on Black hair as it's thinner due to having less cell layers. So a lot of people are really highlighting the fact that these caps help reduce barriers for the sport and underrepresented groups. So I thought that was really interesting. The founders of sol cap, they are two Black men who never grew up swimming. You know, they were always taught or thought like swimming wasn't for me, but they finally took adult swimming lessons and they realized, you know, they saw this woman in the at the pool really struggling trying to put on a normal cap on her hair. So, which if you're a swimmer, you know that it's already really difficult to put those on, even if you have really thin hair. So yeah, I just thought that was really interesting and really opened my eyes as a former swimmer myself. And the BBC did a little series, there's a video in here, we don't have to watch it, but just highlights what Black swimmers kind of go through. So I just thought this was really interesting. And if anyone's familiar with the beauty and wellness section, you'll see that we did a beauty shift called Justice. And this really ties in well with what we speak to there. And we'll be doing a trend story called activism. And I think this would be really great research for that as well. So,
Karen, is there any chance that the Olympic Committee is going to reconsider this for the upcoming Olympics in Tokyo, or they've outright banned it?
They're definitely reconsidering after there's been a lot of backlash. I know the BBC came out and said that the caps would be allowed in smaller competitions, but there's not been an official decision yet on the Olympics. So a lot of people are hoping that they'll reverse it. So fingers crossed.
Got it.
And this is just something fun. So Stranger Things is filming in Albuquerque, New Mexico currently. So that is where I am located. And this morning they were filming a scene right in front of my house. So I just wanted to share this fun little nugget with you guys. So you can see in the left corner, there's like this old mail truck. So that was the scene that they were filming, was just a mail truck going down the street. So yeah, I just thought that was really fun.
I love it. The epitome of true show and tell. I mean, being in New Mexico and Albuquerque, one would definitely think there's some kind of alien inspiration involved here.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Awesome. Taryn, thank you for that. That's awesome. Carrera from our culture team, you're up. Hi.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yep. You're good.
Hi, guys. I'm Carrera, and I am the director of culture at Fashion Snoops. My first link today is this little secret trick for getting around maybe a firewall that might be standing in your way of reading an article. So it's called outline.com, and you basically copy and paste the article you want into there, and it will sometimes work and sometimes won't. It works on Vogue Business. It doesn't work for Forbes, and it doesn't work for Wall Street Journal, but it's something to try if you really kind of want that information. We can try it on, if you go back to the link deck, I have one from, yeah, this is like the test where, I don't have Vogue Business. So to read this article, I just put it into Outline.
Genius.
Yeah.
Thank God.
Such a good discovery.
Yeah, what they say therefore is that like a lot of these sites have like too many ads that pop up, and so their service is that like you can put the article in Outline and it will get rid of all the ads and pictures and just show you the information. But I think on the down low they know that it's really just
this is great. I'm sure you're blowing everyone's mind. Of course we want to support local media outlets, but to your point, this is a great way around other ways.
Absolutely.
Super cool.
Okay, so just in keeping with the fact that I got a library card a month and a half ago, and I've just been being so inspired by books, I wanted to share this book called Be Here Now, Remember. And I brought it in, and if you can, I'm on camera. If you want to like toggle to me, I can show you from the book more specifically. But basically, this book is by this spiritual thinker, Ram Dass, and the start of it's very autobiographical. It starts with him speaking about how he basically had his life made. He was like a tenured professor at Harvard studying psychology. He had like the nicest cars. He was making so much money. He was like the pinnacle of success. But when he would teach classes on psychology, like all the students would be like, oh, well, he knows the answer. And he'd be like, well, honestly, I don't. Like, I can tell you about what Freud said, but it's not like, it's not going to fix anyone. It's not like the answer to any of like the mental problems, or I mean, not that that's the right word, but like any of the issues in psychology that we're facing today. So he went on this really amazing journey. He started, I mean, he was teaching at Harvard around the times that like LSD was like being discovered. And of course, like mushrooms were being discovered in the West, in the sense that they were, you know, they were going to Mexico and speaking with indigenous people to like using the mushrooms and then bring it back to like Stanford and Harvard and all these Ivy League institutions. And so he goes down this rabbit hole of just doing so many mushrooms, so much LSD, and like being like, oh, this is the answer. Like, is this the answer? And it ends up not being. He finds that no matter how high he gets, he always comes down. And so he ends up going to India and studying with different gurus. And he finally finds that like, there is a path to spirituality through like, yeah, like meditation and like yogic practices. And so he changed his name to Ram Dass, which I don't exactly remember what it means. I feel like it means like, you know, like servant or like helper. And the rest of the book, so like it's split into sections. The first section is that autobiographical piece that I just spoke about. And then the rest of it is kind of like what you're seeing on the screen here now. It's all these different pamphlets collected throughout the whole time. And there's, I mean, I love to share it with this audience because just aesthetically, it's so beautiful to see all these different, like, I don't know if you guys can see on like my personal screen, but I'm holding up the little thing. And then, yeah, there's all these really beautiful sayings in here. And then the final part, it's like a three-part book, is a cookbook for a sacred life, which is a really interesting play on like there's a page that says ingredients and it'll say like readiness. And then I guess you go to that page of readiness and you kind of get like instructions on how to prepare readiness in yourself. I don't know. I was just really blown away by this book. It's been around since like the late 60s, 70s, but to kind of rediscover it in 2020 was really interesting to me. That's that on that. And then the next one I have is—
Sarah, I'm just so excited that you discovered Ram Dass. Uh-huh. Well, there's amazing movies. He's done amazing. I mean, he passed away, I think, last year. And he had a stroke, you know, several years ago, but really lived like the most happy person you've ever met. And there's amazing movies, I think, on Netflix. One of them is called Becoming Nobody. There's just amazing films. And there's also a great podcast that, you know, all his followers and people who've listened to all his speeches that are curate and kind of discuss. So he's incredible. So I'm just excited that you've discovered him.
Yeah.
The culture team is always bringing lessons of the universe to us.
Yes. So great.
Even just autobiographically, like the man has undoubtedly lived such an interesting life, and his writing is very approachable. It's very like, look, I know I studied psychology, but some things can't be explained. So that's pretty interesting. Next one I don't personally have, but I really want it. I was in McNally Jackson and I saw this magazine. It's called, I forget now, it's called like The Nature of Things. I forget, can you scroll up? I think it'll say, oh, never mind, scroll down, please.
Life of Things.
The Life of Things, and every issue is like, the issue that I saw was on rugs, which sounds super interesting, or like we've got the desk, we've got trousers, we've got all these different things. And, you know, it's kind of like what we normally expect from like a journal like this, where they take an idea and they just approach it from every different way. So like, of course, like ancient rug making practices, but then also like back hair. There's like an article on back hair, like, you know, they just take it from every different kind of angle. And I might go back and buy this today because I really want it. And then the one thing
before you go on, let's tell everyone about the McNally Jackson stores. I know there's one in Soho. Is that the one you go to usually?
Yes, I go to Soho and I go to the one in Bushwick, but yeah. I mean, they're an independent bookstore that just really has a lovely array of magazines and journals and all the things I love to spend my money on. And because I'm in the Flex office, I'm close to the McNally Jackson, so I might go after work.
Yeah, it's a beautiful store. Everyone should definitely put it on their list if you're not from New York.
Uh-huh. And then the last one, I don't have a link for it. Again, it's just like a book that I've been looking at. It's called Thought Forms. If you go to my little, you go to my square, I'm holding it up in my hand.
So we can't see your square because it's only whoever speaking. But tell me what it is and I'll Google it.
Jenna's holding it up. You guys see it? Can you flip through it? Can you flip through it to just one of the pages?
The one that you have.
Anyone really that has like a nice photo. So the idea of this one, and it reminded me of, this is real show and tell. It reminded me of what we were talking about when we did last season sentiment, where we were talking about all those aesthetics that arose on Instagram during the pandemic that were kind of like very spiritual, very, what sentiment was that? Yes, it was harmony. It was harmony. And it kind of came out of this idea of people wanting to like put like to explain their feelings almost like through pictures or through like scientific drawings. So what this book is, it's called Thought Forms. I believe it's also maybe from the 60s, 70s or 80s, but it's these people who kind of went about the task of like assigning images, or at least they see images or they understand feelings and emotions and thoughts as images. And they'll say like, this is what sorrow looks like. It's this blue color and it's got like these webs that like extend out, like the way they'll always provide a photo of what like sorrow or moodiness looks like. And then they'll explain it in the most beautiful poetic language on the other side of like how and why it's this color and why it's like this different like density. They'll talk about the density of a feeling. And I thought just because we work in color and we work in like, you know, kind of speaking about aesthetics or speaking about feelings and emotions or colors or aesthetics, as for work, I thought it would be just like a really great book for you guys to check out on like how to kind of talk about not the unspeakable, but like things that are really hard to put into words. They do such a good job of that. But then also like categorizing these things that kind of exist in the fluff and the mist of the universe of like, oh, what does like my anger look like? Well, let's draw it like in a scientific way. So I thought, yeah, these were two like really interesting books that I was exploring this month. And those are my links.
Can you just once again say the title of the book for anyone who wants to write it down?
It's called Thought Forms by Annie Besant and C.W. Leadbeater.
Perfect. Thank you.
Yeah.
All right. Next up is Tamara from our active team.
Hi, everyone. I'm Tamara. I'm an active first strategist. So the first link I wanted to share today is from Tim Schutz. So he is a Berlin-based industrial designer who created Process, which is a 3D printed bike saddle. So what makes this product really unique is that each saddle is printed by using data of different physical characteristics and preferences that are unique to each user. So the final product is not based on any traditional market standards or any gender identity. They also use a lot of algorithms to adjust the shape, the size, or the padding, and match it with other ergonomic data to create a 3D model that is completely personalized. So I think it's really interesting to see these kind of designs that are challenging the more conventional gender standards and want to create products with a more gender-sensitive approach and use different processes. And what I thought were also was really cool is that clients have the choice to use the data that is generated to print the saddle in a factory, but also they can gather data and basically print a settle at home if you have a 3D printer. So the process is way more focused on participation and creating a way more decentralized design process, which I thought was really interesting.
This is great. Can they team up with Peloton so that this can be better?
That would be amazing. yeah, and my second link is about Pakistani architect Jasmine Lahri. So she was the first woman architect in Pakistan and has designed a lot of commercial buildings in her country since then. Now she's retired and she approaches architecture in a different ways. So she's basically advocating for an approach based on more traditional materials and construction techniques using mud, lime, and bamboo instead of, for example, concrete, which is more emission intensive. So the materials she's using are characterized by or helping eliminating carbon emissions from the air, as well as being able to be reused multiple times. And yeah, I think this initiative is really interesting because we have been tracking a lot of innovations based on carbon capturing coatings or carbon neutral products that are all based on really new technologies and innovations, but she's approaching it differently through the lens of more traditional techniques and local materials. And what I thought was also really interesting is that she designs also a blueprint for buildings that are based on these local ingredients, and she's teaching local people these traditional construction techniques that that makes people being able to construct their own homes, and especially focusing on, for example, victims of natural disasters that have lost their homes. So I thought it was really interesting to see this idea of really empowering communities through more local initiatives.
This is great. And just more examples of, you know, age old techniques and craft that's being used in the modern world, which we've been talking about for a really long time.
Yeah.
Thank you, Tamara. Those are great. Next up is Amanda.
Hi. Yeah. Me and Tamara are on the same mental wavelength today. I pulled a few links speaking to this idea of natural building. And within the home team right now, we're really exploring, you know, this more vernacular style of architecture. We're seeing so many things go, you know, back to the roots and become more primal or primordial in just the look of and feel of the object. And that extends from everything from hospitality to healthcare and obviously into architecture and design. So a couple companies that I've been finding that are really kind of changing this space, really starting it off within like the new age way, is this first one is Cray. They're based out west, both of them are, and they really kind of specialize in making these beautiful buildings and structures with, you know, all natural materials, so mostly clay and straw. And they're absolutely beautiful structures. Yeah, there's like no, you know, steel or concrete or anything like that. It's all just all natural. You know, there's obviously no emissions or exhausts or anything like that that come out of it. And they just have this beautiful natural feel, of course, and they blend so beautifully in with the surrounding architecture, which is key. It doesn't disrupt the nature. It kind of enhances it, which I loved as an idea. But they really speak about their practices being, you know, a defining past, present, and future. And they talk about how these structures really stand the test of time. A lot of people would think like a clay and straw house doesn't sound very sturdy, but in actuality, it's incredibly sturdy. It's very efficient to build a structure out of. It lasts for decades and even centuries. It's, you know, could be climate sensitive, but there are many ways around that. And they offer workshops. They're really community focused so that anyone can take a workshop and learn how to build a natural structure or just the principles of natural architecture and building.
It's great. So their entire Instagram page is a color palette on itself.
I know. It's beautiful. Gorgeous. And then the second one is Quail Springs. They're very similar. They offer this natural building workshop aspect, and their headquarters, which is also in California, is really beautiful. But they also are a permaculture center. So we're looking at a lot of different ways that people are getting involved in their, you know, local communities, getting back to their roots again. And they offer, they're like a center full of educators and botanists, and they teach local workshops on different, you know, foraging and permaculture, and of course, natural building as well. So I just love finding these great outlets. It makes me want to live in California so I could go to all these places and take these workshops.
You can do it.
I know, good. And then, yeah, this is just an image of the actual Quail Springs headquarters, which is just so beautiful, just visually inspiring. So I wanted to share that.
It's so beautiful. So often when we think of these very primitive inspired structures, you know, these have such a kind of modern contemporary spin on them. Really gorgeous.
Yeah, and then my last link is sort of in the same vein. It's a little bit different. It's called the Shell House. So it's not necessarily made of clay, but it is made of wood and locally sourced natural materials based in what would be the Ukraine. It's a concept at the moment. But it's inspired by the, you know, a mollusk shape. So it's got the biomimicry that we've been tracking. It's really beautiful. They're actually not that big when you see them at scale. They're like, I think meant for two people to up to four people. But they're just, I love the visual design on the outside. Love that it's taking in that biophilia essence. It's just so different for architecture, and it has that great natural building aspect to it, where it's just basically all wood. Really amazing seeing different architects innovate with these natural materials and kind of veer away from those carbon intensive materials like steel and concrete and make beautiful, absolutely stunning luxury products out of it.
Yeah, this was some of my favorite concepts of the week, and everyone tuning in, biophilia was probably one of the most important terms that we used in recent trend immersion events all through our content. So if you're not familiar with it, definitely dig into our reports and learn more about it. Thank you, Amanda. Nia.
Hi, everyone. I'm Nia, the materials director at FS. So before jumping into the video I have here, you all might be familiar with these robots on socials from the tech company Boston Robotics. You might have seen them climbing stairs, opening doors. Everyone seems to be kind of oddly obsessed, but then also completely terrified by the robots. Every time they release a video, but something a little interesting in celebration of their recent acquisition by Hyundai, they just released this dance video challenge in partnership with the popular K-pop group BTS. So really great signal of this kind of like humanistic tech that we've been tracking. So you can play the video. It's really interesting and very entertaining as well. Hopefully it's not too choppy, but... Yeah, so they're slated right now. I think it costs like $74,000 per robot. So I think they're kind of on a push to try to make these I don't know, take the technology to Hyundai or maybe personal robotics for people in the future, but very, very cool. The way they move, it's just amazing. And it's just like thinking from robot perspective, but yeah.
It's crazy. These robots, I think we have been sharing them at Show and Tell for like 2 years now. They save people and now they're in music videos. So
it's amazing. So crazy.
It's crazy.
So for my second link, related to sustainability, which is a big interest of mine, of course, from a materials perspective. So this is actually Barbie's newest release. And it's getting it's a collection made from recycled plastic that would most likely end up polluting the ocean. So they themed it kind of this beachy summer collection. And they say that 90% of the collection is derived from recycled materials. And then for Barbie, it's their latest initiative taken in a mission. Their plan is to become 100% recycled or recyclable or bio-based plastic derived by 2030. So from their products, and then they're also their packaging as well. So that was kind of like a short ad video that kind of sums it up. And then also some of the other things that they've done to kind of diversify their brand and products with the various Barbies that they've released more recently over the years. So I thought this was a great signal. I love that they are calling the future of pink is green. So definitely a cool one to watch out for as well in the toy market.
Another good color story.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks, Nia. And last but not least, we have Hago. Hi, Hago.
Hi, everyone. I'm Melissa Hago, and I'm the VP of Beauty and Wellness. So all three of my links have something to do with each other. We're working now on our trend story laboratorium. So I love this idea of, we've seen biohacking, but this idea of like immersive art and wellness experiences as the future of healthcare. So I have three really cool brands that are doing things that are different. One is launching July in London, another one August in Tokyo. So the first one is this one, The Human. And their whole idea is, experiencing how we rethink what it is to be human and really just transforming healthcare with like luxury clinics and online supplement stores. So you can play some of this. Their Instagram also has some information. So just really cool concepts. And again, I love the idea of like, they speak about scientifically advanced testing and just having a whole group of experts. So physicians, nutritionists, health and mindset coaches. So really just coming at it from that whole thing we've been talking about, mind, body, soul. That's just their Instagram. They have a little bit more information on what they do there, like different supplements, different workouts, and just how they're, again, trying to change how we look at healthcare and being human. So that's one brand. The next one is this really cool immersive sauna. So it was a partnership with TikTok and Team Lab, and they wanted it to be not your ordinary art exhibit, but not also your ordinary sauna. And their whole thing is that they wanted a practice where your mental state is altered and you're really enhanced by like, the sauna. So whether it be by viewing the art and really just changing how, we see art as experience. So another cool one, I don't think we've seen some of like the sleep ones kind of merge with this, but not really the sauna world. So just, another cool one to see how they're bringing in the wellness factor. And if you go, all the way to the bottom, they have like this whole color immersive experience. So super cool as well. And I like, they had a quote, it's like, let me see if I have it here. It's a sign of more wellness resorts integrating art for wellness in their programming and design. I thought that was super strong and really an interesting shift to see. Actually, that's not them. That's the next one I'm showing.
But where is Tokyo? Tell me where this is.
Excuse me?
Where is the sauna?
This one's in Tokyo.
Okay.
Yeah. And then the last one is where that quote came from, the whole integrating art for wellness. This one's in Miami. I shared it with the team as well, since a lot of you are headed to Miami. But again, same kind of complex, kind of concept of like, how can we look at world advancing well-being resorts? So just the whole idea of like achieving things by merging nature, technology, culture. So this one's called Super Blue. And again, their whole thing was like, how can we integrate art for wellness? So just love, all of this like kind of art incorporated. And how can we just kind of, again, merge these worlds of nature, technology, and culture?
Very cool. Yeah, if you're in Miami, check that out for sure. All right, that is Show and Tell for today. We're going to be back in early August with another edition. Hope you feel inspired. Dive into these links, learn more. And if you're not already, make sure to follow us on Instagram @FashionSnoops. Until then, we'll see you next month.